is a parameter estimation for nonlinearly parameterized gray box models. And this is the work of Professor Dennis Bonsman at the University of Michigan. Okay. So the goal of parameter estimation is to estimate either inaccessible parameters or implementation parameters. So what do I mean by inaccessible parameters? So suppose you have this mass spring system, and suppose you measure this force F, and we measure the displacement of mass N1, Q1, and we want to estimate the spring stiffness K2. Now, if the reaction forces FR1 and FR2 were measured, then and the displacement Q2 minus Q1 was measured, then you can trivially estimate the spring stiffness as this expression. But since we don't have these signals, it's not that easy to estimate K2. So the parameters that relate unmeasured signals, we call those parameters as inaccessible parameters. So the goal is to use the dynamics of the system along with available measurements to estimate the inaccessible parameters. So we also estimate representation parameters used in empirical models of complex unbounded physics, for example, stability derivatives in aerodynamics and subgrid models and fluid dynamics models. Okay, so there are some methods available for estimation. Standard methods are typically based on Kalman filter. In extended Kalman filter, we can model the unknown parameter mu as a constant state, and then augment that with the state of the system, and then we get the augmented dynamics. And then we linearize the augmented dynamics, which is now the order n plus l, where n is the order of the dynamics, and l is the number of unknown parameters. And then we apply classical Kalman filter methods to update the states, and then we get the parameter, because that parameter is part of the state now. In UKF, we use the augmented dynamics along with an ensemble size, this size, to update the states and states, and then parameters are again part of those states. Note that in UKF, we need to use the dynamics these many times to propagate the states. So in this work, we propose the retrospective cost parameter estimator, which, unlike EKF, does not use the linearization of the system. Unlike UKF, it does not use the dynamics multiple times. It only propagates the state once. And typically, it also provides state estimates along with the parameter estimates. Okay, so more precisely, this is the problem. We have a physical system model which is evolving per the dynamics map F, dynamics the object map H, and is parameterized by this unknown parameter mu, which can be a scalar or a vector. And we have the measurements of the input and the output. So the problem is, given the input data U and the measurements Y, along with the function dynamics map F and H, the functional forms, not the parameters, we want to estimate mu. So know that in red is unknown and blue is measured. So for example, this linear dynamics is nonlinearly parameterized by mu, where this A matrix is dependent on mu, B matrix is nonlinearly dependent on mu, and hence, again, C matrix is also dependent on mu. Okay, so this is what we do. So we have a physical system, we drive it with an input, that input produces an output with the by the system. We use the model of that system with an estimate mu hat of the unknown parameter mu, which is in red. And this estimation model is going to produce an output, which obviously is not going to match the output of the physical model. We compute the output error, Z, which is y minus y hat, and use that error to drive the parameter estimator and also update the parameter estimator. We use the output error, Z, to update the parameter estimator to produce a better estimate mu hat, and then the hope is that mu hat goes into the system, produces, computes the output, which is closer to the measured output. And hopefully, mu hat converges to mu, and y hat converges to y. So know that this looks very much like an adaptive control problem, where mu hat is the controller output, and we are trying to follow this filter command U. Okay. So the parameter estimator that we where these coefficients mi, ni's, and r multiply the past measurements, past estimates, past output errors, and the matrix r multiplies the integrated error. So gamma is just gamma k minus 1 plus the past output error. The reason we want to include this r is that we know that when z goes to 0, or the algorithm is trying to make, is trying to drive z to 0, and as z goes to 0, we want our mu hat to converge to mu. So this is a system where something, when the input goes to 0, we want the output to go to a steady state, which means we want an integrator in the system. So we are embedding this integrator into this model. So that makes the job of the algorithm easier. So next we write this input-output model in the regressor form, where phi contains all the past data, and then theta contains all these m, n, and r matrices. And then we update these coefficients using RCT. Okay. So this is the idea behind RCP algorithm. So we define the retrospective performance variable as this, z hat equals this expression. This expression is linear in theta hat, and it depends on this filter GF, which we choose. And this GF has a form, has the FIR system form. So it's just an FIR model, like N1 over Q plus N2 over Q squared, and so on. So based on this retrospective performance variable, we define the retrospective cost function, which is basically z hat transpose z hat, and this regularization term depending on beta. And beta is really the sort of a tuning knob for this algorithm. Now, note that this retrospective cost function is quadratic in z hat, and hence quadratic in theta hat. It's going to have a nice, it's a convex quadratic function, so its minimizer is easily obtainable using recursive least squares or just batch inverse. We denote the minimizer by theta star, and then we update the parameter estimate as the latest regressor matrix times the latest minimizer. Okay, so here's the interesting thing about the filter GF. So that the filter GF we have to choose. So after some algebra, we can write the estimate as this matrix, which is constructed using the filter coefficients, times this data matrix. So everything on the right side we know. And this is the matrix constructed using the filter coefficients. So obviously, this vector is always going to be in the range space of this. So if we want to estimate one unknown parameter, a first order filter is sufficient. We only need one single coefficient. It either has to be plus or minus. So if you want to estimate two unknown parameters, then we need this matrix to be random. So we want a second order filter. Okay, so let's look at some examples. So in this example, we have a linear plan which is non-linearly parametrized. So the A, B, C matrices are parametrized by mu non-linearly. We have the input U, which is driving the system, which is given by the sum of harmonics. We assume that we know that. And we assume that we measure the output 1. The actual system has this initial condition, but the estimation model has, we set the initial condition of the estimation model as 0. So we don't use the initial condition of the actual system from where the data is coming in. We set our filter as just simply 1 over Q, so N1 is just plus 1. And these are the tuning parameters, and we see that RCP produces the estimate which converts to the right true value of mu, which is 0.8. So all these mu's were 0.8 to generate the real data. And RCP converges to 0.8, drives the error to 0. The estimated coefficients also converge, and these are the state estimates. In red are the actual, the true states, and in blue are the estimated states. So we don't update the states, we only update the parameter. The system dynamics propagates with the latest estimate of the parameter. Okay, so next to we do sort of a numerical sensitivity analysis of RCP. We keep one of the tuning N1, which is GF equals M1 over Q. We vary N1 over five orders of magnitude, and we see that RCP still converges to the right value. So we can see that the magnitude of N1 is sort of affects the convergence of the algorithm. Next, we keep the filter constant, and we change beta over 8 or orders of magnitude. And we again see RCP is able to converge to the right values for a wide range of these tuning parameters. So it's quite robust to tuning. Okay, so next we estimate the unknown damping in the forced van der Waal oscillator, which is driven by this harmonic. Again, the initial condition of the van der Waal oscillator is assumed to be is set to this, but it's not used by the algorithm. And in the estimation model, we just set it to 0, 0. And again, GF is set to this value with the tuning parameters. RCP produces, estimates the correct value of mu, which was in this experiment, which was set to 1.2. So RCP gets the right value, drives the error to 0 here. We show the error on log plot, the absolute value of the log, absolute value of the error on a log plot, and the estimator coefficients also converge. Also, the states of the van der Waal oscillator converge, and there is no phase lag. Okay, so again, a nonlinear example. We have a nonlinear plan. This car moving back and forth has a pendulum, has this simple pendulum, and we want to estimate the linear friction mu. And these are the dynamics, nonlinear dynamics. We assume that the input u, given by a bunch of harmonics, is again known, and y is the velocity of the car is measured. And the initial state of the model is this, but the initial state of the estimation model is set to 0. So we don't use the knowledge of this state. Now in this case, I have to use a negative n1, so I use minus 0.1, and these are the tuning parameters. Again, the estimate converges to the right value, which was set to 1. The z goes to 0, and the estimator coefficients again converge. Okay, so enough with one parameter. Now we estimate two parameters in a linear plan. So now note that in this system, the A matrix is parametrized by mu1, and the B matrix is parametrized by mu2. So RCP is trying to estimate both mu1 and mu2. The input u is again given by some of our harmonics, and y is assumed to be measured. Again, I use the same initial conditions again and again, but we don't use that in the estimation model. The estimation model initial conditions are again set to 0. Now, note that since we are estimating two parameters, the coefficients n1, n2, and so on are going to be matrices. So I want to choose these matrices as simply as I can, so I want to use basis vectors like e1, 1, 0, minus 1, 0, 0, 1, and 0, minus 1, stuff like that. So in this case, I choose the filter as this combination, set the tuning parameters as this, the values, the estimates, mu hat converge to the right value, so 0.2 and 0.3, error goes to 0, the parameter estimator coefficients also converge. Now, this plot shows the estimate in the parameter space, so mu1 and mu2, and this shows n1 and this shows n2. So let's look at that plot in more detail. Okay, so the size of the filter coefficients is same as the number of unknown parameters, so basically the transpose. So u is a vector and n transpose is a vector. So we can basically plot n on the parameter space. So this is n1, 1, 0. This is n2, 0, 1. This is the true location of the parameter, and I'm showing n1 plus n2. So what do we see? We have done millions of numerical examples, and we note that, we observe that RCP initially searches along the n1 plus n2 direction. It's searching for the parameter. It's always going to search along n1 plus n2 initially. And we believe that it's because of, in the initial phase, there is some lack of persistency, and that's why it's just going into the BC sum of the BC response of the filter. Next, the interesting thing is RCP looks for the correct parameter in the half space defined by n1 plus n2, which contains n1. So sort of just an observation. And that observation has been true for a lot of cases. So in this case, we see that this is N1 plus N2. So this side of the plane, this half plane contains N1. And since that half plane contains the correct value, RCP gets it. Okay. So next, we estimate three unknown parameters. Now, A is parameterized by mu1, B is parameterized by mu2, and C is parameterized by mu3. Again, the input is known, the output is measured, the initial state is unknown, the initial state of the estimation model is set to zero. Now, I have the filter as these guys, and if I want to choose from basis vectors, right, E1, E2, E3, or minus E1, minus E2, minus E3, there are like 48 combinations of these guys. So I just pick the one that works. So this one actually works. The parameters go to the right value, error goes to zero. And these plots show the projection of the estimates on the 1, 2, 2, 3, and 3, 1 planes. So mu1, mu2, mu1, mu3, and mu2, mu3 planes. And again, there are some geometric conditions which these filter coefficients need to satisfy in relation to the unknown parameter so that RCP works. And this is really the price we pay. We don't need any gradients, we don't use any linearization, but this filter really has to, the filter coefficients depend on the plan, and we can't know that a priori. So we have some techniques that we are looking into to alleviate that problem, but that's really where we are. Okay, to summarize, I presented RCPE as a parameter estimation technique. It's gradient-free, it's recursive and completely data-driven, and unlike UPF, it does not propagate these, it does not use the dynamics of the system multiple times. It typically estimates these states as well, and it's, like I showed, it's applicable to nonlinear parameterized models. We also, in this paper, we also analyzed the filter structure geometrically, and like I said, for a scalar parameter estimation, a first-order filter is sufficient. For more number of parameters, we need higher order filters. And then they need to satisfy additional geometric